Well, hello. You might be wondering, what are we doing today? Well, it's simple. We'll be discussing my personal top games of 2019. Why are we doing it? Well, everybody out there has been doing their list of top 5, top 10 games of 2019. And I thought, that's a good way to start the new year. Why not I go ahead and make a video about my personal favorite games of 2019, but we're not going to do top 5 or top 10. We're going to do top 12. But because I'm a special person, we'll be doing things a little differently. What I'm going to do is spice things up. I'm going to rank those games. And I'm going to tell you exactly why I've placed a game in a particular order or why I've given a particular rank to that particular game. So let's start with number 12. I really like this game in terms of its build diversity, in terms of the combat options it provided and the creative expression that this game allowed me to have. And it's nice that I got to play this game and I did not skip this game. I was thinking about skipping this game and most people did. And that is the reason why I consider it to be highly underrated game of 2019. And that game is Code Vein. Is it coming or the light is shining? Code Vein. This is a game I really, really enjoyed. Code Vein is one of those games that hooked me with its anime-like story and surprisingly deep combat system. Code Vein is a third-person action RPG in a Dark Souls-styled package. But Code Vein is anime as anime gets. You've got a dystopian world filled with revenants, which are kind of vampires, a lost queen who has attacked humanity. You have something called the Red Mist, there are blood springs, and then there's these things called the Lost. Code Vein is fully loaded with beautifully animated cutscenes and deepest and the most customizable waifu creator ever created in a video game. But what makes it special is its build diversity. You're not fixed to one particular playstyle. You have the option to create various creative variants. So there's no need to stick to a boring mage or a regular ranger or a brain-dead berserker. Code Vein might be a flawed game, but it's certainly an addictive dungeon crawler like Diablo, which is why I liked it so much. It's got an excellent progression system, though it lacked in terms of its level design, but overall, it allowed me to basically experiment with various builds. And for that reason, I really enjoyed this game. Number 11. There were some games that I really wanted to play and I was excited about, but I did not play because they were not available on Switch, so I'm waiting for their Switch version. And those games are games like Indivisible, hope I'm right. I think so, it's Indivisible, which has this gorgeous hand-drawn art style, and it's an RPG, a turn-based RPG, and it looks very good. And the second game was, I think so, Darksider Genesis. That's a game I really, really wanted to play, but I didn't want to play it on Steam, I wanted to play it on Switch. But there was this game that came out that I happened to play on Switch and I absolutely enjoyed it. Now, when I'm making this list, I take into account the presentation, the story, the vision of the game, what the game is trying to execute. That is very important for me. And if in case a game tries to do something that is novel and unique, that is also something that I account for. Now, this game is not novel or unique, but the vision behind this game and how it was executed was exceptional. And I really enjoyed this game. And that game is River City Girls.
Show this guy's face! Everyone's always punching and kicking each other. Like, everywhere we go, all day long.
You know what? You don't see a lot of brawlers these days, let alone a good one. River City Girls has this lovely colorful pixel art and an awesome synth pop soundtrack. The premise is that your boyfriends have been kidnapped and you need to rescue them by bashing your way through mobs of enemies with moves, counters, throws, combos and special attacks that are drip-fed to you over the course of the game. But what makes River City Girls stand out is its presentation. From its manga and anime inspired cutscenes to its shops and items to its sleek UI. I just love how everything is presented in River City Girls. All I can say is River City Girls is just a constant joy to play through.
No, you take them! You can't silence love, Mr. Rudis! We'll find whoever took our boyfriends and beat them into the street! Also, your lessons are boring!
Yeah, what she said! What's going on?
And I'm again underlining that the soundtrack of this game was exceptional. It was a very good beat-em-up, but the soundtrack was phenomenal. If You Dare, Bully, Rich, Watch Your Back, all these songs were phenomenal. Wait, I think so. Let me see if in case I can give you a taste of something. Let's see. Okay, enough. There we go. Number 10. I'll give you a hint. This is not a AAA game. This is again an indie game. Can you guess which game it is? It is not Grease, which is a game that I absolutely enjoyed. It is not Katana Zero, which is an awesome 2D side-scroller hack and slash. It's a shooter. Can you guess it? Well, I don't blame you, because this is a game that I personally would have missed if in case it was not for this controversy. And I enjoyed this game just like Doom 2016, because it's not bogged down by story exposition or heavy cutscenes. It is brisk, it has momentum behind it, and it's a throwback to old school shooters. Could you guess it? Well, it is Ion Fury.
We're taking over this town.
For sure. Let's dance. My name.
Okay, let's be honest. I would not have known about Ion Fury if it wasn't for this SWJ controversy it landed in. And boy, I'm so glad that I found it. Built in build engine upon which games like Duke Nukem, Blood, and Shadow Warriors were made, Ion Fury looks like it's just a throwback, a nostalgia trip. But in all honesty, it is one of the best shooters to come out this year. I enjoyed Ion Fury for the same reasons I enjoyed Doom 2016. It's a shooter in its purest form. Polar opposite to today's military shooters, which I really don't enjoy. Ion Fury is not bogged down by exposition-heavy cutscenes. Instead, what it relies on is its level design, maze-like corridors with keycards, loads and loads of creative weapons, diverse enemies, open arenas, and exciting encounters. The aspect that made shooters so immersive and so exciting and so engaging has been taken out of shooters. So I'm glad that a game like this exists. Number 9. Now, this is also a game that I thought that I'm not going to enjoy, because it's a 2D side-scroller hack and slash. And I was like, 2019, would I enjoy a game like this? But this game is actually addictive. And that game is Bloodstained: Ritual of the Night. This game was actually, it's hard to explain why this game is so fun, but I'll try to. You know, there's something about 2D Metroidvania design that feels like home. Bloodstained is an exploration-focused side-scroller action RPG that is surprisingly deep and addictively fun. Of course, there's a lot of backtracking, but with excellent level design, interconnected rooms, and varied enemies, it's a joy to backtrack, especially when the combat loop is so well done. The game is wonderfully balanced with loads of creative weapons, items, and abilities to choose from. And what about its music? I just love its music. Though I'm not a fan of its art style, but it does manage to create the right mood and atmosphere. I still feel it could have been more consistent, and that is the main reason why it's not high up on my list. I think so the magical part of Bloodstained Ritual of the Night is that though it has all the RPG mechanics surrounding it, the thing that it nails is its moment-to-moment gameplay, which is so addictive and fun. And I think so that is why Bloodstained is one of those games that you should not miss. And it's on Game Pass. You guys can pick it up. Number 8. Now, this is also a game that would have flown under the radar, and that was because of the publishers themselves. But this game had an excellent balanced gameplay and a decent story. And this game did not require story because of the fact that it's more towards a sandbox kind of a game. But still, it had a decent story. And overall, I thought that this was a package that I really enjoyed. And that game is Anno 1800. If Anno 1800 was just a city builder where you collect resources to keep your inhabitants happy, I might not have enjoyed it. But Anno 1800 lets you lead the industrial revolution, where production is the key. You need to build up your enterprise, figure out your supply chains, figure out your production pipelines, and employ labor to produce high-value goods that you can trade to fuel your economy and your business. The distinctly Victorian-era architecture is evident as you overlap city services such as police stations, fire stations, which in turn supports your people and your factories. Efficiency and effective trade routes is the key to bring more money and resources. Money is in turn used to expand your city as well as your city services, while your resources head to your ports to trade out for extra income, which again can be used to expand your enterprise. Anno's progression is so well balanced that there's always something to do, and it's one of those games that you think that you're going to play for some time, but you end up spending hours on it, and in my case, full night. And my god, this is such an underrated game, and that is because of Ubisoft not promoting it the way they should have done. Out of all the junk that they have produced, I think so this was a gem they should have really marketed. But sadly, Ubisoft will be Ubisoft. Number 7. Now, this is a game that I really enjoyed, though it is not something that is exceptional and something that brings in innovative ideas, but as a package, this was a game that I absolutely enjoyed because it was well-rounded, it ticked all the boxes, and somehow it just captivated me both in terms of gameplay and story. And that game is Gears 5.
What you saw in that vision, every detail.
Multiple security breaches, all the fear of ruin.
External camera 16. External camera 15. Camera 10. God damn it.
They're here.
Gears 5 proves that you do not have to break new grounds or shake up the formula to create a good game. Maybe Gears 5 is not the most bombastic or the goriest Gears game created, but it has the deepest campaign yet. It organically ties into all the previous Gears, expands on the Gears universe, fleshes out the characters, and presents a riveting and emotional tale of bravery, resilience, survival, friendship, and family. It's not that Gears does not introduce anything new, though whatever it introduces seems more incremental in nature rather than revolutionary. But I do like how the world is more open and how Jack adds this extra layer of complexity to the gameplay, while new guns open up new possibilities as you muscle through the epic set pieces and bosses. But the real strength of Gears 5 is how it manages to be a spectacle, yet being personal at the same time. It has this surface level enjoyment of a great third-person action game while being able to hit you on an emotional level. By the end, Gears 5 manages to resolve enough to have a satisfying payoff while having enough threads open to tie into the future sequels. It's a game that I thought, well, would be just another Gears, but it managed to be way more than just Gears. it could have been a rank higher on my list. But it's number 7 on my list because the 6th game on my list introduced new, novel ideas and themes, even though some of the ideas were not executed well. Number 6. Now, this is a game that crumples under its own ambition, but there are few elements that are so unique and there are ideas that are so innovative and creative that I had to put this game on this list. Think of it this way. This game has exceptional two parts, story and gameplay, but the problem is they do not gel together. And that is why this game is not higher on my list.
So here I am.
Järveks luulin, merta kerran, runon lausui hän. Mysteerin sen syövereissä vietti elämän.
Control is a game that has lofty ideas. Individual elements of Control are exceptional. You have one of the best visual and architectural designs I've ever seen. The usage of lighting in the game is outstanding, and it creates that ominous feeling. The gameplay is tight, the animations are solid, the destruction physics are the best that I've ever seen in a video game. Thematically, world building is so rich and deep that it is sad that it wraps around this wildly inconsistent package. Control makes me interested in its world, but forgets to make me invested in its characters. The narrative is all over the place. It explores these confounding ideas that lead nowhere. The end story fails to provide a satisfying resolution. The difficulty of the game is also uneven, oscillating from being too easy to being frustratingly difficult. Some of the bosses are challenging in a refreshing way, while some are frustratingly laborious. Though I muscled through all the bosses, even the optional ones, because of my obsessive kink, but I could not help but feel that they were designed by a sadist just to annoy you. Yes, I'm talking about you, you tentacle freak, and also you, you Tomasi. The very end section of the game is just pure laziness, with the game just throwing repeated waves of enemies at you. I can say this, that Control is a game you should not miss, and it needed to be higher on my list, because I enjoy the kind of intentionally vague narrative it tries to weave.
And that's all I can remember of that dream. This is an ordinary song about an ordinary girl from an ordinary.
I just love how Control does not hold your hands with objective markers and clear directions. But it ends up being so low on my list because it lacks cohesion. But I still cannot ignore the sheer brilliance of what it achieves thematically, visually, and mechanically. Damn, this could have been a masterpiece. Maybe next time, Remedy. I believe in you. Now, before we move ahead, there are other games that I really wanted to point out that I played and could have easily been from 6 to 12 on my list. And those games are Outer Worlds. I played around 15 hours or 20 hours of this game, and I think this is an exceptional game. The only problem is I feel it's unfair if I put this game on my list because I've not played it enough. Now, the other game that I really wanted to play, but I could not play it through, is Death Stranding. Now, this is a game that I can see has a lot of merits, and probably it would have ended up on my list if I would have invested enough time. There are things that cheese me off about this game, but I can see that it's a game that has innovative ideas and a vision that is unique. So I would definitely like to give more chance to this. Now, there's another game that I really enjoyed, but I could not finish it, and that's why I've not put it on my list, is Judgment. Now, this is a game that I really enjoyed. I didn't think that I'm going to enjoy this game to a point that it's going to be my game of the year. I thought it's going to be a fun game, but I really like the story premise of this game. It's a very gamey game, and that's why I really wanted to play this game through, but sadly, I was tight on time again. And that's why I could not play Judgment. The other game that I really enjoyed but have not finished is Metro Exodus, and I wanted to point it out that this is a game that has a lot of good qualities, and this is a game that should not be missed. Number 5. Now, this is a game that could have shot up right to the top of my list, though there are a few execution problems here and there that stop this game from shooting up to the top of my list. But there are so many good qualities about this game. This game is unique, it's innovative, it's got a nice premise. It overall feels like a breath of fresh air. And this is a game that you should not miss. And that is why Disco Elysium is on number 5. Is Disco Elysium a detective game? Is it an adventure game? Is it an isometric RPG? Is it a narrative game or a tabletop pen and paper inspired journey into madness? Maybe it's something of everything. What is for sure is that Disco Elysium is an esoteric, wordy, obscure, strange and weird type of psychological game, and I love weird stuff, especially something that explores the dimensions of body and mind. Disco Elysium is a game that you will think as you play. And the more you think, the more you would want to play to make sense of what exactly Disco Elysium is. Not everything in Disco Elysium is perfect. It does suffer from some pacing issues. It can be slow and it is wordy, at least for some. It likes to explain everything, every action that is going on, even small movements or a twitch in someone's face. And that can get irritating. I can understand that it is not for everyone, but for me, Disco Elysium is just my cup of tea. I love to pick up my tea, coffee, and get lost in its incomprehensible world, experimenting with its dungeon master-like structure, dabble in its main character's fantasy, stoke his destructive ideas and beliefs, and kindle his curiosity. Disco Elysium's writing is subversive, silly, smart, witty, cocky, and self-indulgent all at the same time. And its gameplay is something that is rare yet genius. Disco Elysium is one of the most important games to be released this year. Now, I really feel if Disco Elysium was not that wordy and so self-indulgent in its own themes, it would have been a much better game. Number 4. Now, this is a game that should intimidate me because it has so many activities to do and I do not like doing too many activities in a game. But somehow these activities, how they interplay in this game, provides for a nice experience that I think so is unique to this particular game. And overall, I found this game to be exceptional, apart from the fact that it did not look that good. That game is Fire Emblem Three Houses.
Long ago, the divine Seros received a revelation from the goddess, a gift to help guide the lost. Now, the goddess watches over Fodlan from her kingdom above as the mother of all life. The arbiter of every soul.
Fire Emblem Three Houses at start does feel bland. Its starting sequences are not engaging. It does not feel that the game is setting you up for something big, and the combat feels too simplistic and slow. But when Fire Emblem really opens up, it drowns you with an incredible amount of choice. While the combat evolves from just being a grid-based, turn-based combat system to this elegant interplay between various game mechanics, units with their own gambits, and characters with combat arts. It's not just that the battles keep getting complex. As the game progresses, even the story becomes more compelling and thrilling. Fire Emblem has three houses for you to choose from, each with their own leaders, classmates, and specialities. You as a professor get to talk to every member of each house and learn about their strengths, weaknesses and personalities. All this makes for great characters, excellent story beats and phenomenal plot points and some epic moments. But what makes Fire Emblem package even more appealing is its layers of activities that do not feel half-baked. Fire Emblem, apart from being a tactical strategy game, is also a relationship simulator with flirting, romancing, and even gift giving. Fire Emblem is a game that has lots of activities to do and has a lot of content. And Fire Emblem Three Houses could have been a stellar package if in case the graphics did not feel so dated. There's something about execution in Fire Emblem that I enjoyed juggling between various activities. I do not enjoy that in games, but somehow I enjoyed it And that is why it is so high up on my list. The only drawback, like I told you, is the graphics. And don't give me that excuse that Switch system is not powerful enough. Look at Witcher 3. Look at so many other games that have come out. Look at Diablo, which looks so good on Switch. Number 3. Now, I told you the reason why I didn't like Fire Emblem was because of the fact that it lacked in the execution in terms of its graphics. But this game is so well executed in all of its department, be it story, be it how it looks, how it plays, the music. Everything about this game is so addictive and it puts a smile on your face. And that game is Luigi's Mansion. Now, on the face value, Luigi's Mansion looks like a very simplistic game, but there's something about it that makes it captivating. I cannot pinpoint what it is. Maybe it's the atmospheric music or the ghoulish art style. Maybe it's because of its cartoony pixel-like animation or those cute voices. Or maybe it's the sound that comes as you suck in objects or the satisfying loop of yanking the ghost and pounding them on the ground. Or the wickedness of irritating people with your flashlight. I really do not know. What I do know is that Luigi's Mansion turns the most simplistic gameplay loop into something that tingles your obsessive brain. The attention that has gone into this Nintendo title is insane. Everything in this game is deliberate. Every portion is so well-paced. Every puzzle is fun and creative, and solving it with a co-op buddy is pure joy. It's a must-have for all Switch owners.
Nice. Hello? Whoa. Got it! Yeah! Luigi!
Now, Luigi's Mansion is a game that I absolutely enjoyed, tucked in my bed and just soaking in the experience. And there's something about this game that makes it so special. And if you're a Switch owner, like I said, you have to get this game. Number 2. Now, I told you guys that Control is one of those games that I enjoyed, but it lacked in execution. This game executed beautifully on all the fronts, and I thought that it is not going to be a game that people are going to enjoy. It's just going to be a nostalgia trip. People will definitely like it, but they are not going to give it Game of the Year because it's a remake. But this game is actually so good.
Tell me everything, right from the start.
It's Umbrella's fault, this whole mess. But we never meant for this to happen.
The whole place is coming down.
Hand over the sample.
It'll be all over soon.
You don't know what you're up against.
I have a pretty damn good idea.
Claire, get out. Get out now!
Trust me.
Resident Evil 2 is not just a remake. It's not like the Resident Evil Origins Collection, where the fundamental gameplay remained the same. It would have been much safer if Resident Evil 2 just copied RE2 original beat-to-beat. But Resident Evil 2 shook things up. The developers took the survival horror aspect of the game, its general direction, and changed almost everything. The story beats are reimagined and remixed. The dialogues have been rewritten so that they do not feel cheesy anymore. To be honest, there was a certain charm to the cringy and cheesy dialogues, but I understand that the game needed to be modernized. Speaking about modernization, the combat mechanics are modern enough to feel tight and fluid, but have the right amount of wobble and jank to give that old school survival horror feel. As the game progresses, you feel more capable and better equipped to deal with things. But at the same time, the inventory system, guns, and ammo are so perfectly balanced that you always feel the tension of running out of options. This tense survival aspect of the game is perfectly matched with rainy, dark atmosphere, meticulously crafted interconnected level design, and a well-paced story.
How are you holding up?
I'm hanging in there.
Hell of a night, huh?
Yeah. You find your brother?
I did, actually. He's... I Just when you think it can't get any worse. Leon, you should get going.
Resident Evil 2 is not just a remake, it's a crowning achievement. Now, to be very honest, I had super low expectations for this game. In fact, I was worried. But this game has been so surprisingly delightful that it has come up to number 2 on my list. Now, before we move forward, there are a few games that I want to point out that could have been on my top 5 list. But for some reason, I have chosen to not include them in my list. And those games are Sekiro. Now, Sekiro is a game that I can see the merit behind it, but I have to play it more to even judge this game. The other game is Final Fantasy XIV. Now, this game looks gorgeous in all its departments, story, gameplay, everything. I'm talking about the Final Fantasy XIV's latest expansion. But there's so much of content to go through that it intimidates me to reach to the latest expansion. But I can see the merits. I've seen the gameplay videos. I've seen walkthroughs for this game. And I can tell you that this is one of the best Final Fantasies that is out there right now. The other game is Astral Chain, which I could not find in India. And probably I have to get it from outside India. But this is a game that I think I'm going to enjoy. But because I could not play it, I cannot put Astral Chain on my list. The other game is Dragon Quest XI S, which is again a game that I could not find in India, but that's a game that could have made it to my list. I just wanted to point that out. Now, the number one game on my list is something that was recommended by Steam to me. Steam said, you know what? You enjoy story-rich games. You might enjoy this one. And I picked it up because it was pretty cheap. And I absolutely enjoyed this game. And this game is Plague Tale Innocence.
Why does she keep resisting like that? Only our methods differ. We have the same goal. We both fight the plague.
Plague Tale Innocence is pitch perfect in its narrative, pacing, sound, and visual design. Its gameplay design, though largely experimental, just fits into the theme of the game. The game's stealth system perfectly blends in with the narrative that it's trying to establish, and its environmental puzzles fit perfectly in the world it is trying to create. Set in the 14th century, Plague Tale Innocence pulls from one of the darkest times in human history and authentically recreates it with its stellar art design. Its music and sound design complements the nuanced story of death and survival. You know that the game's execution is close to perfection when you're being forced to find something negative about it. All I can think of is that the enemy difficulty remains the same. They become predictable and can be easily avoided using the same tricks over and over again, which to some extent mitigates the challenge of surviving the dangers of the Middle Ages. There is little to no replay value. But then, there are also no microtransactions or any paid DLCs. It's a complete package, which makes the experience even more refreshing.
I'm sorry, I'm sick.
No.
Now, to be very frank, Resident Evil 2 and Plague Tale Innocence were very close to each other. The only reason why Plague Tale Innocence is bumped up to the number one position is because of the fact that it is unique, it's a new IP. So I felt that this is a game that needs to be on the number one list. Though I thought a lot about that. I really wanted to put Resident Evil 2 on my top list, like number one on my list. But I think so Plague Tale Innocence deserves it. But before we end it, there's one more thing. I've not announced my Game of the Year. Now, Game of the Year is a game that is exceptional in the departments that I've mentioned. It is exceptional in its execution, and I personally enjoy it for some reason. So there's a lot of personal bias in this game also. Though, I feel even if in case I take out the personal bias, this game easily would have been my Game of the Year. Now, to give you a hint, This game actually got 9s and 10s from all the review sites out there, but somehow magically disappeared from the top list games. And I feel that's unfair. So what is my game of the year? What is the ace up my sleeve? The game above all games.
Devil may cry.
I got a gig. Cash up front.
Cash up front. This I like. The water needs turning on and those toilets need flushing.
Devil May Cry 5 had probably the toughest job. It had to come back after a decade of obscurity. It had to undo the changes and the damage done by the DMC reboot. It had to wrap up the five-story saga, completing the circle started by Devil May Cry 1, all while appealing to new and old fans alike. And Devil May Cry 5 nailed it. It successfully completed the story arc, bringing references from not just the games, but anime, manga, novels. You see characters growing up, perspectives being changed, all while providing a satisfying resolution. Devil May Cry 5 has a consistent vision and flawless execution, technically, mechanically, and artistically. It is not just the best game to come out this year, it is hands down the best melee action game ever created. Its combat is perfected to Mirror's Sheen. It has one of the best rosters of boss encounters. It sets the rule of engagement and keeps them consistent throughout the game. It offers a level of creative freedom that is unmatched in this genre. You have tools that offer tremendous flexibility and it motivates you to try different playstyles. You can have near endless combinations of weapons and moves while their animations seamlessly flow into one another. It's like performing arts, where you keep practicing your dance, perfecting it to match the music. Devil May Cry 5 goes beyond just an action combat game. I thought it's going to be a eulogy for the series that pioneered 3D action games. But instead, I found a celebration with obvious callbacks, the most crunchy and satisfying combat ever in a video game. Devil May Cry is easy to pick up, but has limitless heights to its mastery that will be explored for years to come. And that is why Devil May Cry 5 is my game of the year. And it's a game that I played the most this year. Well, after Overwatch. So, this was my top 12 games of 2019 plus my game of the year. Hope you guys enjoyed it. I enjoyed doing this. Probably we might do it next year. I hope so. But if you like this video, don't forget to subscribe to us and do like this video. This was ScanKicks. You were watching Mixed Up. Take care and have a fantastic year ahead.